Good afternoon. The next item of business is portfolio questions. In order to get in as many members as possible, I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Fiona Hislop.
To ask the Scottish Government what additional action it plans to take to tackle gender-based harassment in schools in light of its response to the report Misogyny, a Human Rights Issue.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
A range of actions are being taken forward to address gender-based violence and harassment in schools. Alongside relationships and sex education, there are a number of targeted programmes to support positive behaviour and relationships, mentors in violence prevention to tackle gender stereotyping and attitudes condoning violence against women and girls, Equally Safe at School to tackle gender-based violence, and Fearless to educate and support pupils to speak up about crime. The Gender-Based Violence in Schools Working Group are developing a national framework to ensure consistent messaging on gender-based harassment for everyone working with young people.
Fiona Hislop.
The Scottish Government will be aware that organisations such as Girl Guiding Scotland and Zero Tolerance have called for the introduction of more specific gender equality and consent-based sex and relationship studies as part of Curriculum for Excellence. Can I ask what progress the Scottish Government has made to address these calls for preventative measures to be taken, and if such an implementation is to go ahead, what support and resources can the Scottish Government offer schools and local authorities in the meantime to ensure teachers are confident in dealing with any complaints or reports of sexual harassment in their schools? And it wasn't quite clear from the original answer what additional measures have been taken place by the Government in addition to the measures you just said in response to the report, Misogyny, a Human Rights Issue.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Fiona Hislop for raising this very important issue, and I'm very grateful to the organisations that she mentioned for engaging with the Scottish Government. The Government obviously wants all children and young people to develop mutually respectful, responsible and confident relationships, and that's why we're committed to ensuring all children and young people receive high-quality relationships, sexual health and parental education, so pupils learn about safe and healthy relationships. We'll shortly bring forward a consultation on revised RSHP teaching guidance, which is seeking to provide a focus on learning and teaching about gender equality and consent education. In the meantime, and alongside the initiatives already mentioned, Education Scotland's National Improvement Hub contains resources to support professionals. We are, of course, also committed, as part of our shared policy programme with the Scottish Green Party, committed to exploring what further actions beyond those already planned, including guidance for schools, are required.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. On the 16th of December 2021, I raised this matter with the First Minister, and she confirmed that she would look into the situation with regard to local authorities, their responsibility for the Wi-Fi that's operated in schools, over which much of the bullying and misogynistic attacks are taking place. Could the Cabinet Secretary follow up on this and find out what the current position is with regard to the Scottish Government and that responsibility?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, very clearly we've said in the past that online bullying should not be treated any differently than face-to-face bullying. Obviously, it is the responsibility of local authorities to address the use of Wi-Fi in their schools rather than through national government, but certainly the Scottish Government is very keen to work with national government, with local government and the organisations that I spoke about earlier to see what more needs to be done to be tackling all harassment in schools, but particularly in relation to this aspect around the sexual harassment bullying that goes on within schools. And we're very determined to work with local authorities and partners on that, both online and offline.
Question number two, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what the expected timetable is for the Race Equality and Anti-Racism in Education programme to report.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is fully committed to addressing the issues which continue to perpetuate racism within schools. The Race Equality and Anti-Racism in Education programme's ambition is to create real, tangible and lasting change rather than to issue one single report. Effecting systemic change takes time, and working in partnership with stakeholders on the development and delivery of the programme, and as such is a long-term commitment. As part of that process, we're currently working with stakeholders to develop a shared vision and a set of actions with realistic timescales and milestones attached. These will be key to providing a clear idea of when the ambitions can be met. We expect that, subject to stakeholder agreement, the programme will be published in this summer and will be underpinned by an evaluation framework for the REAP, which is also being developed in partnership with stakeholders.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The programme the Scottish Government has set up is important and upheld its work so far. But we cannot afford for this to be a missed opportunity to ensure that the curriculum itself is inclusive and representative. Can the Cabinet Secretary reassure me that curriculum reform will be given equal weight to its other considerations?
Cabinet Secretary.
I can absolutely confirm that the curriculum reform is one of the four key parts, the key areas that REAP is looking for and will act upon. There has been progress to date and, as I've said, we'll publish more information about the programme in the summer if stakeholders would agree. But we are seeing already some examples. For example, Education Scotland has begun rolling out the Building Racial Literacy Programme. We've seen the new National Race Diversity Lead being appointed by the General Teaching Council for Scotland. That is a couple of examples, and as well as Education Scotland also developing the Whole School Resource for Practitioners entitled Promoting Race Equality and Anti-Racism Education. But I would absolutely confirm that the reforming of the curriculum is one of the key strands of the work that we will publish details on in the summer.
Co-Cap Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the Minister join me in recognising the work of local councils, such as Glasgow City Council, in passing a motion to support decolonisation of the curriculum and has produced a modern studies guide for its schools? I would like to ask for an update on how the Scottish Government is supporting all local authorities to ensure that Scotland's colonial history is acknowledged and reflected in the curriculum.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I commend local authorities, including Glasgow City Council, as recognised by Co-Cab Stewart, for the work that they are already doing to prioritise anti-racism education. We're drawing on good ideas such as that and the good practice that's emerging from different parts of Scotland as part of the REAP. And this programme does, as I've mentioned to Faisal Chowdhury, obviously include curriculum reform work streams as part of that, which is currently reviewing the Curriculum for Excellence framework. That's a very, very important piece of work, but I would commend Glasgow City Council and others for being so proactive in the work that they've been doing on this issue.
Question number three, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Education Secretary has had with the Circular Economy Minister regarding progress to enhance education and skills for a circular economy.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
I last met the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity on Wednesday, 4th of May, discussed the role of the tertiary sector in promoting and supporting the development of, among other things, the skills required for the circular economy.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Scottish Government promised to recruit circular economy teaching champions. As of 2020, fewer than 100 teachers were involved out of a total of more than 24,000 secondary teachers. Does the Minister accept that this isn't good enough progress after 8 years, and what steps have been taken to train more circular economy teaching champions?
Jamie Hepburn.
Well, of course, what the member has laid out is progress. Of course, we'd like to see more. I recognise absolutely the need to make sure that young people are equipped with the necessary understanding of the world around them, and actually, in relation to my area of activity, an understanding, a deep understanding of the type of skills intervention they will require to take advantage of the opportunities that will exist through the circular economy. Of course, the work he has mentioned will continue. I recognise we need to keep doing more in that regard, and if the member wants to write to me, I'll be happy to get back to him in further detail.
Question 4 has been withdrawn, and we'll move on to question 5 from Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action is being taken to increase subject choice for secondary pupils.
Cabinet Secretary.
Young people should be able to access a range of pathways that meets their needs, abilities and aspirations. Schools and local authorities are encouraged and supported to consider innovative ways to ensure There are a wide choice of courses available to the learners. It is for them working together with partners to plan course choices in their area.
Oliver Mundell.
That's all very well and good, but what would the Cabinet Secretary say to my constituent who says, as a parent of an S3 pupil who's picking her options for next year, I'm concerned at the narrowing of the curriculum and education generally at such a young age. We have relatives in England at the same age of my daughter, and they will be sitting 10 exams next year. It doesn't compare and surely leaves children here in Scotland lacking a wide and rounded education and massively disadvantages her against her peers in other parts of the UK and indeed other parts of Scotland, where children still get to sit 8 subjects at National 5 level. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree there should be a minimum number of subjects offered to all pupils in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
One of the important issues which was raised by the OECD quite rightly was the importance of having a discussion around the breadth and depth of education within different years of the high school setting. Oliver Mundell may think that it is the recommended approach from what he says, that a young person should be sitting 10 exams, and that is the good practice that we should be aiming for. But I would point to him again about the OECD work that absolutely does consider that Scotland should have a discussion around ensuring that, yes, children and young people have a broad and deep education, but we need to get that balance correct. Of course, it is up to the schools, and I think it is quite right that it is up to local authorities and to schools to make sure that they are designing curriculum that is right for them, right for the children and young people that are before them, and right for the communities that they are there to serve. So, yes, we should combine that national discussion, but we should also, I think very importantly, leave it to local authorities to make final decisions that is right for the children and young people that they know best.
Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She knows that members are greatly concerned about the narrowing of the curriculum in terms of the qualifications that people and the experiences that young people seek. In the broad experience of senior phase pupils, I was greatly concerned in terms of reports this week relating to the Scottish Government seemingly shelving plans for the Erasmus scheme, or replacement scheme, that replicable model in Wales actually is reaching into the, particularly the young people in later years of schools who have lost experiences in the last couple of years. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm, Presiding Officer, when we will see that plan for a replacement in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the Minister who's right beside me today has made clear on many occasions, we are discussing the scheme with stakeholders at this time. I think it's very important that we do discuss that with stakeholders and we take those discussions in an in-depth level to make sure that we make the decisions that are appropriate at this time. It is clearly something that we deeply regret, and had Scotland not been forced out of the European Union, a situation we would never have got ourselves into, apart from having to deal with Brexit.
Willie Rennie.
But the Minister still can't explain why Wales were able to do this last year with a £65 million fund, means that many, many students in Wales and from other countries have been able to benefit from that right now, but Scotland, under the SNP, have been unable to move a single inch. When are we going to get this replacement for Erasmus? If Wales have done it, surely Scotland can.
Cabinet Secretary.
And we've looked very carefully at what has been introduced in Wales, as Mr Rennie would expect us to. That's part of the discussions that we're having with stakeholders, and we will of course make announcements on a replacement in due course.
Question number 6, Maggie Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether industrial relations in the college sector could be improved by applying fair work conditions to funding provided via the Scottish Funding Council.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
I expect the Scottish Funding Council to continue its progress in adopting Fair Work First, both as an employer and through attaching Fair Work First criteria to its grants, procurements and other funding.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for his response. Dundee and Angus College staff and others have been in touch with me about management delaying negotiations, causing additional strike action and disruption to students by refusing to meet for over 1.5 weeks, concerns that this is an attempt to wear the unions down, anger at the disproportionate bloating of management and rise in management pay compared to that of lecturers. If principals' pay had increased in line with lecturers' pay, it would be around £90,000 a year rather than £164,000 a year. Does the Minister agree that it is unacceptable for college management to delay talks to grind the unions down, resulting in another week or more of strikes and disruption? Will he instruct college management to get back around the table until a fair pay deal is reached? And should we be limiting the pay rises of management to ensure staff and student support services don't suffer?
Minister.
On the fundamental point of the question, in terms of ensuring that both parties are at the table, this is something I have emphasised previously, publicly in this chamber, directly with the College Employers Association and with Colleges Scotland. I have no hesitation in saying to them and indeed to the unions that I want to see them round the table negotiating this in a timeous fashion and hopefully being able to resolve it together.
Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, President Officer. Of course, Maggie Chapman's right. The people that suffer most in this situation are the students who are having their studies, their assessments and their final tests massively disrupted, creating huge uncertainty for them and for their futures. But it doesn't help that the colleges sector in Scotland have had a core budget cut from the SNP at the very moment when they should be at the heart of a Scottish economic transformation. So, Minister, how many jobs in the college sector will be lost because of this SNP cut?
Minister.
Well, of course, what Mr Kerr omits, maybe he's forgotten, or I don't know whether he deliberately omitted the fact or neglected to say that the Scottish Government is dealing with a 5.2% reduction, real terms reduction, exactly, in funding as a consequence of UK Government decisions. But what I can say is that the decisions we have taken this year has not only been a maintenance in terms of the core college sector resource, but an additional £10 million through your Young Persons Guarantee, an increase of £41 million in capital funding, and other funds such as the £5 million capital funding for digital poverty. So we are stepping up, we are supporting that sector, and we are supporting students.
Question number 7, Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made with regard to supporting pupils with neurodiverse conditions.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are committed to ensuring that children and young people, including those with neurodiverse conditions, get the support needed to reach their full potential. Last year, we published our updated ASL Action Plan and Progress Report to deliver the Morgan Review recommendations. We will publish a further update in the autumn. Last year, we also published our Progress Report on the Autism in Schools Action Plan. The majority of actions are complete, but we acknowledge there is more to do to improve the support offered to neurodiverse learners. We continue to engage with partners to take this forward.
Karen Adam.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Presiding Officer, I have met with people who feel that there is gatekeeping to help support and a lack of understanding of neurodiverse conditions. Either a behaviour issue or educational issue must be noted before support is offered. But many neurodiverse people can be seen to pass and even thrive in academic and social situations due to masking. This can have a profound impact on many aspects of their lives. Can the Scottish Government give assurances that the many aspects of neurodiverse conditions, such as eating disorders, chronic pain, anxiety, depression, vulnerability to manipulation and bullying, will that be given the focus that they deserve?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can absolutely reassure the member that in terms of education, a formal diagnosis is not required for a child or young person to receive support with their learning. If a child or young person needs additional support for any reason, including the circumstances that has been mentioned, then the Education Authority has a duty to identify, provide for and review that support. I am aware of the issue of masking of autism symptoms, particularly in young girls, and I would be happy to meet with the member to discuss this if she would wish to go into it in further detail.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The mental wellbeing of pupils with neurodiverse conditions should be of paramount importance. Can the Minister outline how the Scottish Government supports this, both in the classroom setting, but very importantly in extracurricular activities, to ensure our schools are as inclusive as they can be and provide that much needed support and opportunity?
Well, The member raises a very important point about what's both inside the school setting and extracurricular activities. Clearly, I've spoken in my original answer about the Autism in School Action Plan. There is, of course, the Autism Toolbox, which is a free online resource that's been developed, hosted by Education Scotland, to support the inclusion of autistic learners. But if there are particular circumstances or a particular point, perhaps from a constituency issue, that the member has in mind, I would, of course, be happy to receive further details of that in writing.
Question number 8, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what progress it has made in closing the attainment gap among school pupils.
Cabinet Secretary.
Closing the poverty-related attainment gap remains a key focus of the Scottish Government and speaks to our wider mission to reduce child poverty. Over the course of the last Parliament, there was demonstrable progress on a number of long-term measures to close the poverty-related attainment gap, with attainment gaps in literacy and numeracy narrowing pre-pandemic in primary schools. We know that COVID-19 has made our ambition of achieving equity in education harder, but our increased investment of £1 billion in the Refresh Scottish Attainment Challenge programme is empowering local authorities, headteachers and teachers to identify evidence-based approaches that are right for children and young people in their schools to tackle the attainment gap.
Annie Wells.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but the attainment gap remains stark. It's at its highest level since 2017, and despite the ambitious rhetoric from the First Minister, it is frustrating that evidence continues to point to education not being this government's number one priority. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that following years of damaging cuts to local government funding, councils and schools have one arm tied behind their back as they work to close the attainment gap?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would point once again to the £1 billion worth of expenditure in the Scottish Attainment Challenge alone that is on of course, in addition to the local government settlement, I would also point out the 3,500 additional teachers that will be funded by the Scottish Government. We already have 2,000 more teachers than we did pre-pandemic. This government has and will continue to take action to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap. We were seeing progress before the pre-pandemic, and I am sure with the Refresh Scottish Attainment Challenge funding, including over £500 million directly to our head teachers empowered through our system, that we will see progress once again.
Eleanor Whittam.
Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that since the SNP government formed in 2007, Scotland has the highest spend per pupil in the UK, and attainment and the number of pupils going on to positive destinations has improved 95.7% and 98.4% in East and South Ayrshire respectively, both in my constituency, and that this is down to the SNP Scottish Government's funding to reduce the poverty-related attainment gap to give it its full title, empowering schools and teachers who know their pupils best? And this is in sharp contrast to the UK Government's colossal failure of a tutoring scheme. It is clear that it is only SNP who can be trusted to give children the very best opportunities we can against a backdrop of continuing Tory austerity and the spiralling chaos of the cost of living crisis.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Mr Kerr may not like that from a sedentary position, and he probably didn't like the local government elections last week as well, which proved that the Scottish people have once again put their trust in the Scottish National Party, both at national and local level, because they see the action that is being taken on this issue. Eleanor Whittam is quite right to point to the work that we are doing across government to tackle child poverty and to tackle the cost of the school day. That includes, of course, the extension of free school meals, the Scottish Attainment Challenge that I mentioned in my original answer. And it's very important that the government has and will continue to take action on this issue.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. The next item of business is a statement by Shona Robison on update on cladding remediation programme. I'll allow a moment or two for members to move seats.